बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम
के पास नहीं आ रही।
आई वेलकम यू ऑल टू दिस वेबिनार ऑन द टॉपिक ऑफ करंट पॉलिटिकल सिचुएशन एंड इमर्जिंग इकोनॉमिक प्रॉस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ अफगानिस्तान एंड द रीजन। आई एम एक्सट्रीमली ऑनर्ड एंड हम्बल्ड टू हैव विद अस टुडे द वेरी इनिमिटेबल, हाईली रिस्पेक्टेड, रिवर्ड एंड अक्लेम्ड एंड अ पर्सन ऑफ ग्रेट क्वालिटीज, जनाब सरताज अजीज साहब, and esteemed scholars like Dr. Aqdas Afzal and Professor Dr. Sayyed Hasnat Shah. So, I'd like to introduce the honorable guest speakers. Sartaj Aziz Saab needs no introduction. A well-known and renowned figure of the political and government institutions of Pakistan, he has served as the Deputy Chairman of the Planning Commission of Pakistan, member of the federal cabinet as the de facto minister for foreign affairs, a federal senator, as well as the national security advisor. Sartaj Aziz Saab was an activist in the Pakistan movement. He studied economics at the Punjab University and later studied public administration at Howard Kennedy School. Sartaj Saab has served as a civil servant from 1952 to 1971 within Pakistan's federal government. Also served as the Joint Secretary in the Planning Commission between 1967 and 1971. In 1971, Sartaj Aziz joined the Food and Agriculture Organization, FAO, and served as its Director of Commodities, only to move to the International Fund for Agriculture Development, where he served as the Assistant President, Policy and Planning between December 1977 to April 1984. Sartaj Aziz Saab returned to Pakistan in 1984 and served as a junior minister for agriculture and food security until 1988, under the Junejo administration. He was elected to the Senate of Pakistan in 1988 and re-elected in 1993 from the Pakistan Muslim League Nawaz Sharif party, and served in both Sharif administration, first as the Minister of Finance from August 1990 to June 1993 and Minister of Foreign Affairs from August 1998 until 1999. So it's a great pleasure to have introduced Sartaj Aziz Saab, who is certainly not that figure which needs any introduction. And Sartaj Aziz Saab, you have also been in the academia and became the Vice Chancellor of Beacon House National University and have taught economics at the university. And you have authored a book titled Between Dreams and Realities, which was published in 2009. And you also remained with the university until 2013, when you joined the Nawaz Sharif's third administration as an advisor in charge of country's foreign policy, and also served as the National Security Advisor between 2013 and 2015. So quite a loaded and very remarkable CV kind of yours. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us. Dr. Aqdas Afzal, the next speaker, he has attended the Ohio State University. He earned his bachelor's in political science and economics with a minor in Farsi. In 2006, Dr. Aqdas completed his master's in political science from the Ohio State University and returned to Pakistan from 2006 through 2012. Dr. Afzal worked in the development sector in both Lahore and Islamabad. Additionally, he taught as an adjunct faculty member in the economics department at the Lahore University of Management Sciences and at the Government College Lahore, University Lahore. In 2011, Dr. Afzal won the prestigious Fulbright Scholarship to pursue a doctorate in economics at the University of Missouri, Kansas City, USA. In 2013, Dr. Afzal interned at the United Nations in the New York City. In 2015, he won the Association of Institutional Thought's prestigious Student Scholars Prize in Economics. So while at the University of Missouri, Kansas City, Professor Afzal taught as an adjunct faculty member at the Rockhurst University in Kansas City, for over a year, and Professor Afzal has also participated in many seminars. And he has also presented his research in several economics conferences in the United States. Professor Afzal has also published in the Kansas City Business Journal, Journal of Economic Issues, and the International Journal for Pluralism and Economics Education. Thank you so much, Dr. Afzal, for joining us. The last speaker is Dr. Sayed Hasanat Shah, who is a PhD in the field of world economy. Currently, Dr. Shah is working as professor of economics in Jilin University, China. He is the founding member of Belt and Road Research Institute and director of foreign students affairs at the School of Economics in Jilin University. Dr. Hasanat also served State Bank of Pakistan both in the capacity of strategic planning officer and economic analyst. He was a visiting faculty at the Qaeda Azam University, Islamabad, for a short period of time. He is the alumni of AERC, this institute where I'm having this webinar, and Qaeda Azam University. Thank you so much, Dr. Hasanat, for joining us. So with the permission of the valued panelists, I'd like to start off by introducing the topic of the webinar. As we are aware that our region, that is South Asia, is home to 1.94 billion people, of which 39 million, excuse me please, around 2% live in Afghanistan. So in terms of population, Afghanistan seems to be an insignificant part of South Asia. Yet the mention of South Asia in any policy discourse inevitably leads to Afghanistan, which is now seen as the pivot upon which hinges the stability and future of South Asia and the region. A stable Afghanistan, many experts basically concur, is the pathway to a stable South Asia. This is certainly true for politics. But if one looks at the Afghan economy in regional terms, one tends to downplay the significance of Afghanistan, which is important, neither from the perspective of what and how much its economy contributes to the region, nor from the perspective of geostrategic location that has made Pakistan indispensable to China and the Western powers. Afghanistan is landlocked and depends greatly on Pakistan for its transit trade. And roughly 54% of Afghanistan transit trade imports travel through Pakistan. The Afghanistan GDP per capita is the lowest in the region. It is disturbing to see that despite billions in overseas development assistance and many programmatic interventions by bilateral and the multilateral agencies and financial institutions, Afghanistan only does better than Nepal on the GDP per capita scale in the South Asian region. As we all know, and you definitely know this, that Bangladesh has a much larger population, and even with similar characteristics of the turbulence and ethnic conflicts, it has managed to outpace both India and Pakistan to become the regional leader in per capita income. And that's very heartening to see that its GDP per capita surpassed India in 2021. As we all know that Bangladesh history of political turbulence, it seems trivial compared with Afghanistan's. Economists, they basically say and agree that the political stability is vital for the development of institutions, and good institutions are the guarantors of economic growth. So, however, the fact that political stability is economic growth's antecedent, it does not automatically imply that economic problems have to be analyzed through the political lens, and there could be sustainable political solutions to economic problems. So, nowadays, while I have been reading about this topic, I came across some political experts' analysis on various factors that are contributing to the deadlock in Afghan's policies politics and discuss potential solutions that could pave the way towards sustainable peace in the region. But however, this focus has diminished the importance of economics and the fact that the problem in Afghanistan is at least as much economic as it is political. So I think the policymakers, they need to attend to this aspect and view the region from an economic lens to enhance their understanding. So I anticipate that with these few words, I anticipate that our respective panelists, you will enlighten us on the subject, keeping in view their rich experience of the past and vision for the future. So first of all, without much ado, it is my privilege to invite Sardar Aziz Sahab for his expert discourse on the subject. So, sir, over to you.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Thank you very much for your kind introduction and the opportunity to address this webinar on a very important and topical subject. Before I come to the present political situation, let me mention a brief historical background to generate interest among students to study the Afghan history, because it's a very rich history. Almost 250 years ago, in actually 1747, when Ahmed Shah Abdali gained freedom from Iranian occupation, he set up a dynasty, a monarchy, which lasted almost 200 years. And he, of course, was a great conqueror. His conquests even included Delhi, which he made it several times. You would remember Mahmud Ghaznavi, who attacked Somnath Mandir many times and finally destroyed it. So it was a very glorious period. The last emperor, king of Afghanistan, was Zahir Shah, who ruled for 40 years from 1933 to 1973. And at that time, Afghanistan and Kabul were very peaceful and relatively modern. In fact, many Pakistani families in the 70s used to go to Kabul for a cheap holiday because it was very peaceful and they could watch Indian movies and eat cheap food and so on and so forth. So it was a very peaceful period. But their misfortune started in the mid-70s when Russia decided to extend its sphere of influence to Afghanistan to gain proximity to the Indian Ocean. And initially, they persuaded Dawood, who was King Zahir Shah's cousin, to dislodge him and take over. But they realized that that was not working. They even merged the two communist parties, Parcham and Khalq, into a new party. But that didn't work. So in December 79, Russia decided to invade Afghanistan to take complete control. And obviously, Afghan population has never accepted foreign domination and foreign rule. So there was a spontaneous upsurge to counter this insurgency. So in that process, seven new warlords emerged. We all heard the name of Gulbuddin Hikmatyar, Rabbani, Sayaf, and Dostum. And so these seven warlords began to counter the Russian occupation. 2 years later, 1981, USA decided to teach Russia a lesson and with Pakistan's help, they provided first small weapons, then stingers to the Mujahideen groups. And ultimately in 1989, 10 years after the attack of Afghanistan, they decided to leave because they had suffered very heavy casualties. I think 13,000 Russians were killed, 35,000 were injured, but more than 1 million Afghan were killed in that war. And almost 5 million were displaced as refugees, 1.5 million to Iran and 3.5 million to Pakistan. So that was the legacy that happened. And at that time, they left the country. But then when the USSR left, and having brought so much misfortune, which continues till today to them, the Americans inflicted another tragedy on Afghanistan by abandoning Afghanistan soon after the Russians left. If they had spent even 5% of what they spent after 9/11 in Afghanistan and helped them reconstruct and helped them to rehabilitate, Afghanistan today would be in a different place. But every Western country closed their embassies in Afghanistan and walked away, totally abandoning it. So this was the second tragedy which fell on Afghanistan. And that is the context in which Taliban emerged. Because when the seven warlords after the Western countries left started fighting each other for their zone of influence, the Taliban actually were the soldiers of these seven warlords. And they said, we didn't fight the Russians for this. So they actually revolted against their own bosses. And at that time, they emerged in 94 in Kandahar under Mullah Omar, who tried to take action against some local warlords. And then by 95, they captured Herat. And by 96, they captured Kabul. So that is how, and by 98, they had captured almost 98% of Afghanistan. Only Ahmad Shah Massoud was in Panjshir Valley and Badakhshan, otherwise they had taken total. Even a bigger strategy then struck Afghanistan after 9/11, when they blamed Afghanistan because Mullah Omar was, Mullah Osama bin Laden was there. And therefore, they attacked Afghanistan ferociously and killed Desi Cutters and large number of them. And they, of course, did not realize the ground situation, that foreign occupation is not easy to handle, and a government which does not enjoy legitimacy and is installed by the foreigners does not command the support of the people. So, in fact, there was a very good opportunity for them to invite the Taliban to join the government, but they ignored that. They think, we'll destroy them, we don't need to bring them in. And even after they captured Osama bin Laden in May 2011, they stayed on for another 10 years rather than leave Afghanistan, trying to remold it, bring democracy there, bring change, and build a new nation and even prosperity. But they were not able to achieve any of their... meanwhile, Taliban, of course, were regrouping and rearming themselves. And so they gradually occupied some rural areas and kept spreading. And in the last phase, they moved to the cities. And on 15th August, they were able to overwhelm, because the 300,000 Afghan National Security Forces hardly put up any resistance. They realized there was no chance once the Americans had left. So that was the historical context in which the tragedies that befell, because the people of Afghanistan have suffered enormously. So in this background, the current situation. Now, like the and most of Afghanistan history, the current phase is also full of ironies and contradictions. The first irony is that Taliban's smooth takeover avoided a major civil war that everybody expected. If the Western expectation that the Afghan security forces will hold on for 6 months or 3 months, we can imagine what that meant. I mean, Kabul was destroyed in 92 because Hikmatyar had attacked Rabbani, who was not leaving the presidency as agreed. So now most of the cities would have been again destroyed. So in a way, it's a very providential thing that the civil war that everybody expected did not. But West is not happy with that, because because they are not prepared to admit their own follies and their wrong strategies. And therefore, I don't know what alternative they have in mind. Do they want a civil war to resume between Pashtun and non-Pashtun? So this is a very major irony before us. Okay, how do the Western world treat them? The second irony is the Taliban's own ability to rule the country. Qualities you need for fighting a guerrilla war and winning is very different from the qualities you need for ruling a country. And this is particularly true because most of the Afghan professionals are non-Pashtuns, Tajik, Uzbeks, and Hazara. The number of proportion of educated graduates in, among the Pashtun population is much smaller than the non-Pashtun. And most of these non-Pashtuns are very unhappy about a Taliban takeover because of the strict code, and they would like to leave the country. So if all the professionals leave, how would they rule Taliban? A comparable factor is also their own ideological problems. While they want to appeal to the world and they made some positive statements, general amnesty, everybody can leave if they want to, women and girls will have the right to work and study. But their own ideological constraint, particularly the conservative elements of Taliban, are not prepared to go that far. So we see that they're not walking their talk so far, and the world that way is disappointed. So these are the three ironies before us, that while they have won, their ability to rule and satisfy the international community is not very great. Now, the gravity of these ironies that I listed becomes overwhelming when you realize that Afghanistan is also on the verge of a serious economic crisis and a very grave humanitarian crisis. All the stocks of food and medicines are virtually exhausted. Banks have hardly any money, and the level of employment and under nutrition and hunger is extremely easy. It was in any case 50-60% before the Taliban takeover. Now it's almost 80%. So the UN is warning against this crisis. Now, this is the context in which we look at the economic, as was pointed out, that the let's recall that the Afghanistan was a very one of the poorest countries in the region even before the Taliban takeover. And as just mentioned, its per capita income is only 508 compared to 1260 for Pakistan, 1960 for Bangladesh, and 2200 for Iran. And a population of 38-39 million, its GDP is only 78 billion. So, as a result, therefore, and tragically, as mentioned, the large inflow of foreign aid, which was 7-8 billion in the last years, which is almost 10% of Afghanistan GDP, hardly much anything reached the people of Afghanistan. Most of it was went back to U.S. contractors and their subcontractors. About 10-15% stayed in Afghanistan, but was misappropriated by senior officials through corruption. The only thing that helped the Afghan people, and particularly young people, were jobs in schools and hospitals, health sectors. But that was confined to rural, urban areas, because rural areas, the insurgency level was high and very few development activities could take place. And therefore, we had this. Now, in this background, US has imposed further hardships by freezing $9 billion of foreign currency reserve, which Afghanistan was holding in US banks. And the World Bank and possibly Germany has also frozen the billion plus aid that was in the pipeline. So that way they lack liquidity. And as a result, the humanitarian crisis is extremely serious. Now, in this context, the UN has appealed to all the countries to provide some assistance. European Union has announced a billion euros for the humanitarian assistance. UN has also mobilized a billion. So they may get $3-3.5 billion in the G20 summit, which is coming, but it will last a few weeks. And they don't want to give it to the government. They want to channeled through NGOs whose staff is depleted, but it may stave off the worst, but for a few weeks, unless the bigger issue, which is the international recognition of Taliban, which is still a long way off, and therefore we are in this crisis. Now, let's look at this economic background and its impact on Pakistan, the overall situation. The third of dimension of this one. As someone said very wisely, no matter who rules Afghanistan, it has always been a problem for Pakistan. When 47 Pakistan was born, Afghanistan was the only country which opposed Pakistan's entry into the United Nations. Then they always questioned the Durand Line and said our boundary should be the Indus River and not the Durand Line. And then after 79, when the Russians invaded Afghanistan, we had a flood of refugees, drugs, and guns. And at that time, international sort of compare against terrorists when we joined after 2000, after 9/11, we suffered tremendous insurgency. Why are you supporting the US war on terror? And we lost in the process 80,000 casualties, almost 3.5 million displaced people in Swat and Waziristan, and also about 150 billion of economic losses. So we suffered enormously at that time. And in the process, the government of Afghanistan, instead of recognizing our role, tried to help India to engineer insurgency in Balochistan and other parts of Pakistan. So that was their reward. Now, after the Taliban takeover, we face renewed danger of terrorist revival, because they are all encouraged by the fact that Taliban have taken over. And similar apprehensions are there among Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, and even China and Russia, because they all have their own respective terrorist group. And so this is the first danger to Pakistan, that Afghan's victory has encouraged all the Islamic movements to say, why not we? And the second major implication or negative fallout for Pakistan is the blame game. Instead of recognizing our sacrifices, our role, they are saying, why did you support the Taliban? They should recognize their own follies and their own fair strategy, but they are blaming us. And in the process, Pakistan-US relations, which are very important otherwise, are being coming under great strain. But the most serious consequence of the deteriorating economic situation in Afghanistan could be another flood of refugees, because they are all now gathering up along the border, and the pressure on Pakistan is increasing to open our border. Because in the meanwhile, we have constructed a wall and introduced a visa regime. We are already still hosting 3 million refugees, and we can't afford anymore, but we are being under pressure to open. So in this context, the pressure on Pakistan for smuggling, both of currency, of goods, will also increase. Already the pressure on our exchange rate is caused partly by, because Afghanistan has no money, so the Afghan traders are buying foreign currency in Pakistan to be able to finance the smuggling of goods. And so, and in the meanwhile, of course, as more flour and sugar and oil, foodstuffs are smuggled to Afghanistan, we'll have shortages and maybe even higher prices. So this is the sort of five major impacts of the Afghan situation, political and economic on Pakistan. To respond to this crisis, Pakistan, of course, has been in touch with regional countries, China, Russia, Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, Iran, to adopt a collective approach to the issue of recognition. And but they have their own apprehension. And Pakistan is under threat after the blame game, not to support the Taliban totally. So Pakistan has also slowed down these efforts because of the US pressure vis-a-vis the IMF package as well as the FATF, and therefore Pakistan has slowed down its effort on the recognition. To sum up, therefore, unless the international community recognizes that sustainable peace in Afghanistan, peace and stability in Afghanistan is possible only through engagement with the Taliban, and giving them time to organize themselves and respond, unfreeze the assets, and increase humanitarian assistance. And but part that part is the international community. But the second part is how Taliban rule Afghanistan. If they respond and become more flexible, more inclusive, and recognize human rights and others, then there may be a meeting point. And but meanwhile, my real worry is that the people of Afghanistan, who have suffered so much in the last 40 years, are now in the throes of even a bigger economic and humanitarian crisis. And let's hope to God that it will be shortly. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir. That's a very illuminating, very informative discourse. If nobody is going to ask anything, then probably I like to ask you that it's very, very important, and you have very correctly said that this is the history of this region, especially Afghanistan and Pakistan, that Afghanistan has always been a very unfriendly and ungrateful neighbor for us. and a troublemaker to some extent. But I would still like to argue and ask you very humbly that I still am very optimistic about that if we talk about the collective approach of the countries in the region, not only Pakistan, maybe the Pakistan would be in a leading position, but other countries, an important country like China, which is very important economically in the region, and Russia as well, if these countries are not able to, hopefully, I really pray for them to be very successful. If they are not going to do anything positively with Afghanistan, engaged Afghanistan in a very positive manner, so that the Afghani people, then the Taliban themselves, if they can make them understand what is better for them to grow economically after such a long time of suffering, don't you think that the joint effort is not going to, I mean, apart from the what US or the Western powers are thinking about it, and if they're not playing very positive role in it, but the regional approach would be, I think it would give some impetus.
Yes, that's what I think Pakistan's expectation was, and it became very active in the first 3-4 weeks.
Really?
And
okay.
I think, but it's not now ready to play a leading role, but it's a supporting role. I think China is in a better position to play that role, and so is Russia. But they have also not disengaged with Taliban. They kept their embassies open, both Russia, Iran, and also China, which is good, and Pakistan also. So they are engaged with Taliban, and Russia has invited a meeting next week with Taliban with other countries. But as I mentioned in my statement, they are worried about their own version of the extremist organization. I think if on that subject, the Taliban were to be more forthcoming, TTP for Pakistan, ETIM for China, Uzbek movement for Uzbekistan, and also for Russia, I think they will then move forward more openly. Right now, they are waiting for a clear signal from the Taliban. And of course, ISIK is also a major factor in that context. So I think Taliban, while the other Western demand for human rights and minority rights is okay, but for the regional countries, controlling terrorist group is a bigger issue. So if they respond positively to that, I'm sure China and Russia will take the initiative. Pakistan and Iran will also join. And then these few countries can jointly recognize Taliban, and then the process can start, and many other countries will join. So I agree with you that the regional approach is the best, but it depends on a few countries.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. Dr. Abdus or Dr. Hasna, any one of you would like to say something or ask Dr. Sartaj Ji, sir?
I think Sartaj sahab ne bada comprehensive analysis pesh kiya hai, so I don't have anything in the shape of a question right now for the gentleman.
Okay, thank you so much again. So, the next guest speaker is Dr. Abdus Saab, sir. Over to you, Dr. Saab.
Ji, shukriya. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. My name is Dr. Abdus Saab, and I am a faculty member at Habib University in Karachi. And I've had the unique distinction of having taught at NUST, Islamabad, and LUMS in Lahore. So, I've taught at all the three big urban centers of Pakistan. I've had a very long association with AERC now, spanning over a few years, and I am very thankful to Dr. Samina Khalil, under whose able leadership we have been organizing and talking about some of the very pressing issues facing Pakistan's economy as such. Main, agar aapki ijazat ho, to main dono angrezi aur urdu mein agar baat kar lun, if that's okay. तो मैं सबसे पहले ये कहना चाहता था और मैंने सरताज साहब से भी ये को बताया था शुरू में मैं समझता हूँ आई वुड बी रिमिस इफ आई डिड नॉट मेंशन दिस के सरताज साहब के साथ एक पैनल पर बैठना मेरे लिए पर्सनली कितनी बायस फ़ख्र है क्योंकि जब से मैंने आँख खोली है मैंने सरताज साहब को आई हैव सीन हिम एंगेज इन नेशनल सर्विस इन वट एवर कैपेसिटी जो कि इन्होंने किया, और रिसेंटली मैंने एक वेबिनार अटेंड किया जो कि आईबीए करवा रहा था कराची में, एंड आई हर्ड द स्टोरी दैट सरताज साहब टोल्ड अबाउट हिज इन्वॉल्वमेंट इन द पाकिस्तान मूवमेंट एंड सो फोर्थ. और उसमें एक बड़ा अजीब सा कनेक्शन है, क्योंकि सरताज साहब मुझे याद पड़ता है कि इस्लामिया कॉलेज लाहौर में पढ़ रहे थे उस ज़माने में, और माई ग्रैंड फादर जिनका नाम गुलाम रसूल था वॉज अ फैकल्टी मेम्बर एट द सेम इस्लामिया कॉलेज. तो मुझे याद पड़ता है कि जब वो हयात थे मेरे दादा, तो उन्होंने बताया कि इस्लामिया कॉलेज वॉज रियली अ सेंटर ऑफ द पाकिस्तान मूवमेंट और द मुस्लिम स्टूडेंट्स हु वर एक्टिव. तो ये इनकी सरदार साहब की ये भी खिदमात हैं इस हवाले से, और अभी वेरी थैंकफुल टू हिम फॉर हिज सर. मैं यहाँ पे चंद नुकात आपके सामने पेश करना चाहूँगा. मेरा ख्याल है कि सरताज साहब हैज़ प्रेजेंटेड अ वेरी कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव एनालिसिस, एंड वेरी लिटिल कैन बी एडेड टू व्हाट ही हैज सेड, बट आई विल ट्राई टू समराइज हाउ आई सी द अफगान सिचुएशन, एंड देन आई वुड लाइक टू एंड विद थ्री की सजेशंस और पॉलिसी सजेशंस टू आवर पॉलिसी मेकर्स, सो दैट दे कैन टेक दैट मैसेज टू अफगान पॉलिसी मेकर्स हूएवर दे आर or whoever they are going to be in the medium term. To dekhiye, main samajhta hu ke the kind of problem that we are not problem the challenge that we are facing with the recent political turn of events in Afghanistan is a very significant one. In the 1980s, when the Soviet Union decided to send its troops to Afghanistan, at that time the total population of Afghanistan was around 15 million, or then we saw that we eventually got 3 million refugees. So that is about 22 to 24% of Afghanistan's population back in the day. Abhi Afghanistan ki population is touching 40 million. Aur agar takriban 2 se 3% log bhi, aapko yaad hoga ki 24% aaye the last time. Agar 2 se 3% bhi Pakistan ka rukh karte hain as refugees. So that number right now is 1 million extra Afghan refugees. And you see, we are in no position to deal with so many more refugees because we ourselves are a poor and a developing country. So sabse pehle main aapki tawajjuh mabzool karane ke liye ye statistic aapko dikhana chahta tha ki this is a very significant problem that we are looking at. Dusri cheez ki Afghanistan, even before the ye jo current political a change of events hua hai, unki economy was a demand driven supply constrained economy, usme there was a huge fiscal gap and they had been struggling to cover that fiscal gap because of very very weak revenues and a majority of their budget, I mean different figures aate hain, 60% 65% ka figure bhi dekha hai ki that was basically the foreign aid flows that were being made available to Afghanistan which have stopped because of the takeover by the Taliban regime in Afghanistan. Even before the current takeover, 90%, jaise ki Sardar sahab ne bataya, of the population lived below the international poverty line, which stands at $1.90 per day. So ye kuch halaat the that Afghanistan was facing. Immediately after the Taliban takeover, एक खास किस्म की सिचुएशन डेवलप हुई है जिसको केन्जियन इकोनॉमिस्ट्स या दूसरे इकोनॉमिस्ट लिक्विडिटी ट्रैप कहते हैं, यू नो, बिकॉज ऑफ वेरी फंडामेंटल अनसर्टनिटी इंक्रीजिंग इन अफगानिस्तान. एक इमीडिएट सिचुएशन बनी जिसमें दे वर मैनी रनस ऑन द बैंक्स इन अफगानिस्तान, द ATMs वर आउट ऑफ द मनी, और बैंकिंग क्राइसिस डेवलप हो गया बिकॉज बैंक्स ने पैसा डिस्पेंस करना बंद कर दी है, और जिसके पास जो करेंसी या लिक्विडिटी थी वो उस पर बैठ गए हैं अफगानिस्तान के अंदर. सो देर इज हार्डली एनी क्या कहना चाहिए करेंसी और लिक्विडिटी एक्सचेंजिंग हैंड्स इन अफगानिस्तान राइट नाउ, विच इज़ अ वेरी वेरी डायर सिचुएशन, बिकॉज इसका फिर एक नेगेटिव मल्टीप्लायर क्रिएट होता है इन द सिस्टम, एंड द सिस्टम कम्स टू अ कम्प्लीट हॉल्ट. Economists have been saying that in the next 2 years we can expect the Afghan economy to contract almost 25%. But in tamam cheezon ka jo asar hai wo Afghanistan ke andar गुर्बत ऊपर भी होगा, मोर पीपल वुड बी पुश्ड बिलो द पॉवर्टी लाइन, बट इन द इमीडिएट शॉर्ट टर्म देर गोइंग टू बी मैनी मैनी मोर प्रॉब्लम्स, बिकॉज एक तो वहाँ पे पैसा ख़त्म हो गया और दूसरा ये कि विंटर इज़ अप्रोचिंग एंड विंटर इन अफगानिस्तान इज वेरी 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 सिवियर कम्पेयर टू दिस पार्ट ऑफ द वर्ल्ड. तो आई थिंक ये कुछ ऐसी चीज़ें हैं कि which basically force us to take this situation very very seriously. Dusra jo yahan pe kaam hua wo ye hua ki because of the Taliban takeover, international capital flight has taken root in Afghanistan, jiski wajah se unki currency has depreciated significantly, and that would result in a hyperinflation, amplifying the problems that the Afghan people are facing. I mean, Afghan people are already facing a lot of problems in the shape of not having liquidity, not having jobs, not having enough kya kehna chahiye, food essentials or medicines, because jo unki international reserves the almost $9 billion ke, wo bhi IMF ne rok liye. To ye badi ek serious situation, aur is tamam situation ka Pakistan ke upar kya asar hoga, वो भी सरताज साहब ने बड़ी खूबसूरती से बताया कि वही कि वो रेफ्यूजीज़ का एक इन्फ्लक्स, एक एग्जोडस आउट ऑफ अफगानिस्तान इनटू पाकिस्तान. और मेरा ख्याल है कि जब प्रेशर बढ़ेगा तो मुझे ये नहीं लगता कि हमारी पॉलिसी मेकर्स वुड बी एबल टू होल्ड ऑन इन्फिनिटली. इफ यू नो अ लॉट ऑफ पीपल आर डाइंग इन अफगानिस्तान, दे विल हैव टू, समथिंग विल हैव टू गिव. तो इसमें कुछ चीज़ें हैं जो मैं कहना चाहता हूं कि देखें, पाकिस्तान एक गरीब मुल्क है, हमारे पास बिल्कुल फिस्कल स्पेस नहीं है अफगानिस्तान की मज़ीद जो पॉपुलेशन यहां पे आएगी उस पर पैसे खर्चने के लिए. हमारा जो लीडिंग अनकंडीशनल कैश ट्रांसफर्स प्रोग्राम है इस कंट्री में, जिसका नाम एहसास किफालत या जिसको पहले BISP कहते थे, हमारी टोटल एलोकेशन उस अनकंडीशनल कैश ट्रांसफर्स को तकरीबन $170 billion है, which is nothing. So hum already under stress hain by the IMF to kehte hain na, put our fiscal house in order. So we just don't have any fiscal space to spend on any refugee population that will be forced out of Afghanistan into Pakistan. Ab sawal ye paida hota hai ki is situation ke andar what can be done. Hum sabko pata chal gaya hai ki ye badi serious hoche, to usme maine aapse arz kiya tha ki I will make 3 concrete policy proposals जो मैं अपने policy makers को address कर रहा हूँ, people like सरताज साहब, and ताकि मैं चाहता हूँ कि वो ये message लेके अफगान policy makers के पास जाएं और उनको ये message दें कि what needs to be done in Afghanistan. देखिए, सबसे पहली चीज़ जो करने वाली है, I think that has to do with political changes that must take place in Afghanistan. और ये it is easier said than done, lekin I think in the medium term we have to focus on political certain political issues. Afghanistan mein basic problem ye hai, and I was doing a study of how unka constitution kaise bana hua hai. I mean, it's a constitution that gives a lot of power and weight to the center, to the government in Kabul. Aur uska problem ye hota hai ki jab काबुल अपना गवर्नर अपॉइंट करता है किसी सूबे के अंदर, किसी प्रोविंस में अफगानिस्तान के अंदर, तो ऑफन टाइम्स जो लोकल इन्फ्लुएंशियल पीपल हैं, जो लोकल पीपल हैं उन सूबों में जिनके पास पावर है, उनके साथ उस गवर्नर का प्रॉब्लम होना शुरू हो जाता है, विच लीड्स टू वायलेंस. और हमने ये देखा है अफगानिस्तान के अंदर कि अफगानिस्तान के अंदर देर हैव बीन वेरी स्ट्रॉन्ग सेंट्रीफ्यूगल टेंडेंसीज. तो आई पर्सनली थिंक कि अफगानिस्तान के अंदर इन द मीडियम टर्म एक नया पोलिटिकल आर्किटेक्चर या कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन के ऊपर बात करने की ज़रूरत है, विच शुड बी मोर इंक्लूसिव, बिकॉज अफगानिस्तान में सिर्फ पश्तून नहीं रहते. आई मीन, पश्तूनज आर ऑलमोस्ट 39-40%, बट हजारज आर 25% एंड 22% आर ताजिक. सो आई थिंक अ न्यू कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन दैट नीड्स टू बी कॉन्टेम्पलेटेड, जिसके अंदर एक नॉट ओनली एक इंक्लूसिव एंगल हो, बल्कि गवर्नमेंट शुड प्रॉबली रोटेट बिटवीन द 3 मेजर एथनिक ग्रुप. तो मैं यहाँ पे एक कॉन्सोसिएशनलिज्म या कॉन्सोसिएशनल डेमोक्रेसी की बात कर रहा हूँ, जो कि हमारे पॉलिसी मेकर्स को भी सोचना है जिसके बारे में, और अफगान पॉलिसी मेकर्स को भी सोचना है. तो ये आई एम पुटिंग डाउन दिस प्रपोजल ऑन द टेबल दैट इन द मीडियम टर्म अफगानिस्तान शुड थिंक अबाउट डिवेलपिंग अ कॉन्सोसिएशनल डेमोक्रेसी विच इज़ ट्रूली इंक्लूसिव. सेकेंड, और कि मैंने डॉन में भी लिखा था इसके बारे में, ये समझता हूँ कि दो अफगान सोसाइटी इज फेसिंग टू कॉम्प्लेक्स प्रॉब्लम्स. द फर्स्ट इज द फॉर्मेशन ऑफ अ पॉलिटिकल गवर्नमेंट. ठीक है, वो एक बहुत ही कॉम्प्लेक्स और विकेट प्रॉब्लम है, बट आई थिंक एक सेकेंड प्रॉब्लम है और वो है इकोनॉमिक मैनेजमेंट, स्टेबलाइजिंग द इकॉनमी. एंड द टू challenges need to be dehyphenated or the link between them needs to be broken. Political government ke upar bahut zyada time lagega banane ke andar. Aapne bhi dekha hai ki unhone jo king zahir shah ke zamane ka jo constitution tha usko ek basic form mein introduce kiya hai as a policy architecture. Lekin I think economic management mein fill for kuch actions lene ki zarurat hai aur usme aapko टेक्नोक्रेटिक पीपल या जो लोग सेंट्रल बैंक की फंक्शनिंग या मॉडर्न मैक्रो इकोनॉमिक मैनेजमेंट को समझते हैं उनको पोजीशंस ऑफ पावर में लाने की ज़रूरत है. जैसे कि एक नाम मेरे जहन में आता है डॉक्टर उमर ज़खीवाल का, वो यहाँ पे पाकिस्तान में अफगानिस्तान के एम्बेसडर भी रहे हैं. इस किस्म के लोगों को सेंट्रल बैंक में लगाने की ज़रूरत है ताकि अफगानिस्तान के अंदर कोई ऐसा मैकेनिज़म बनाया जा सके कि वहाँ पर मनी प्रिंटिंग भी शुरू हो और वहां पे कैश के इंजेक्शन की जा सके इनटू द इकोनॉमी. एंड फाइनली मैं ये समझता हूँ कि एट द सोशल लेवल बहुत से चेंजेस करने की ज़रूरत है. उसमें नंबर वन मैं ये वार्निंग देना चाहता हूँ क्योंकि मैंने दो बहुत ही इंटरेस्टिंग केसेस स्टडी किए हैं, जो कि पहला केस है कि जब एलाइज टेक ओवर नाजी जर्मनी और दूसरा केस है कि जब US टेक्स ओवर इराक. दोनों कंडीशंस के अंदर एलाइज ने एक पूरा प्रोसेस किया जर्मनी में जिसको कहते थे डी नाज़ीफिकेशन. तो जो जो लोग नाज़ी पार्टी के साथ किसी भी तौर से मुंसलिक रहे थे उनको निकाल दिया गया. यही चीज़ अमेरिका ने इराक में की टू इट्स डेट्रिमेंट, कि जो डी बाथीफिकेशन की गई, जो पूरी की पूरी सद्दाम हुसैन की आर्मी थी उसको एकदम ओवरनाइट घर भेज दिया गया. दैट देन बिकेम वो रिबेलियन जिसने फिर अमेरिका को वहाँ से निकाला. तो मैं ये वार्निंग देना चाहता हूँ अपने पॉलिसी मेकर्स को कि वो कन्विंस करें अफगान पॉलिसी मेकर्स को कि जो अफगान नेशनल आर्मी को ओवरनाइट घर भेजती है और जो उनके पास नौकरी नहीं है, किसी ना किसी शेप में उनके लिए कोई यूनिवर्सल बेसिक इनकम या कोई प्रोमिसरी नोट या कोई प्रॉमिस टू पे देम इन द फ्यूचर होना चाहिए. क्योंकि अगर आपने इतनी बड़ी आर्मी को घर भेज दिया तो इवेंचुअली अफगानिस्तान में मैसिव वायलेंस क्रिएट होगा और जिसका फॉल आउट पाकिस्तान के ऊपर होगा, अगेन इन द शेप ऑफ वेपन्स, ड्रग्स एंड रेफ्यूजीज, जो कि हम ये देख चुके हैं 1980s के अंदर. मेरा ख्याल है कि मैं बाकी तमाम चीज़ें जो हैं वो सरताज साहब ने बड़ी खूबसूरती से बयान कर दी. और ये आखिरी बात मैं कहना चाहता हूँ कि देखें, अ लॉट ऑफ पीपल सीम टू थिंक दैट पाकिस्तान इज प्रोबेबली यू नो पाकिस्तान वर्जेस ऑन बीइंग अ फेल स्टेट. यू नो आई मीन दिस इज अ नैरेटिव दैट वी हियर कमिंग आउट फ्रॉम वेस्टर्न कैपिटल्स. लेकिन मैं ये समझता हूँ कि पाकिस्तान के चैलेंजेस हैं, लेकिन पाकिस्तान के जो स्टेट इंस्टीट्यूशंस हैं दे हैव शोन ट्रिमेंडस इनोवेशन एंड एजिलिटी. उसमें अगर आप NCOC की एग्जांपल लें, ये जो अभी कोविड का क्राइसिस आया पाकिस्तान में, कैसे सिविलियन और मिलिट्री इंस्टीट्यूशंस हैव कम टुगेदर टू फॉर्म दिस क्या कहना चाहिए जॉइंट इंस्टीट्यूशन दैट देन हैज टेकन अ लॉट ऑफ वेरी हार्ड कॉन्क्रीट स्टेप्स इन पाकिस्तान. मैं समझता हूँ कि इसी किस्म का एक नई बॉडी बनाने की ज़रूरत है कि फॉरेन पॉलिसी एस्टेब्लिशमेंट, economic establishment or military establishment, they all need to come together so that Pakistan can deal with its foreign policy challenges that seem to be growing by the day. Main yahan pe apne remarks khatam karunga aur fir se shukriya ada karunga Dr. Samina Khalil ka ki unhone mujhe ye opportunity di, aur finally Sartaj sahab ka jo ke hamari younger generation ke liye inka career is a beacon. और मैं फिर से कहना चाहूँगा कि मैं बहुत शुक्रगुजार हूँ कि आपने अपनी तमाम ज़िंदगी पाकिस्तान की सर्विस के अंदर सर्व की है, और इंशाल्लाह अगर हमें भी मौका मिला तो हम इन्हीं इसी तरह पाकिस्तान को सर्व करेंगे. शुक्रिया.
बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया डॉक्टर अब्दुल सफजल साहब, थैंक यू सो मच फॉर अ वेरी इंफॉर्मेटिव डिस्कोर्स. अगर कोई और सवाल कहीं से आ नहीं रहा तो मेरा ख्याल है कि मैं आपसे थोड़ा सा ये पूछ लूँ ज़रा सा कि देखिए, हम पाकिस्तानी होने की हैसियत से एक हमारा इंटरेस्ट जो अफ़गानिस्तान में है, जो आप शॉर्ट टर्म इंटरेस्ट तो मैं खैर नहीं कर सकते, ये लॉन्ग टर्म इंटरेस्ट बेसिकली है, लेकिन इसमें मसला ये हो रहा है कि पाकिस्तान हमारे लिए एक ऐसा ट्रेड रूट बन सकता है जो सेंट्रल एशियन कंट्रीज़ तक जाए, ताकि हम बड़े कॉस्ट इफ़ेक्टिव तरीके से बड़े इकोनॉमिकली सेंट्रल एशियन कंट्रीज़ तक पहुँचें और फिर बायलैटरल मल्टीलैटरल और काइंड ऑफ ट्रेड्स टू बूस्ट द इकॉनमी ऑफ इन द इंटरेस्ट ऑफ द कंट्रीज इन द रीजन, स्पेशली इन सेंट्रल एशिया। तो ये जो मुझे एक बड़ा चैलेंजिंग प्रॉस्पेक्ट नज़र आते हैं इकॉनमी के लिए, आपके ख्याल में ये हुकूमत जो है हमारी किस तरीके से अफगानिस्तान अफगान गवर्नमेंट को या जो भी इस वक्त सेटअप है गवर्निंग सेटअप, उसको ये कन्विंस कर सकते हैं कि भाई ये आपके भी बेनिफिट में है, हमारे भी बेनिफिट में है, सेंट्रल एशियन कंट्रीज़ के भी बेनिफिट में है, कि क्योंकि मुझे पता है कि कुछ इदारे ऐसे हैं इस पर डॉक्टर हसना शाह जो है इस पर मेरा ख्याल है कि काफ़ी लाइट डाल सकते हैं, क्योंकि ये चाइना में हैं, ये बड़ी अच्छी तरीके से समझते हैं सेंट्रल एशियन कंट्रीज़ को भी, जो चाइना का इंटरेस्ट उसमें है। तो ये बस थोड़ा सा ये बताइएगा कि ये एक ऐसा बेनिफिट है लॉन्ग टर्म में शॉर्ट टर्म में पाकिस्तान के लिए और इसकी इकॉनमी को ज़बरदस्त तरीके से बूस्ट करने के लिए। ज़ाहिर है कि हम एक्सपोर्ट करेंगे, हम ट्रेड करेंगे तो हमारी इकॉनमी का एक रिवाइवल हो सकता है, क्या ऐसे स्टेप्स लेनी चाहिए कि अफगान गवर्नमेंट जो भी है इस वक्त उसको बहरहाल फॉलो कर सकें, उनको जो है कन्विंस कर सकें इस इशू पे।
मैं भी कुछ कमेंट्स करूं इनकी
जी जी ज़रूर ज़रूर सर बिल्कुल।
इनकी तीनों पॉलिसी रिकमेंडेशन बिल्कुल सही हैं, किस हद तक पाकिस्तान उन पर अमल करवा सकता है वो तो वक्त बताएगा, लेकिन बुनियादी बात यह है कि अफ़गानिस्तान के प्रॉब्लम जो हैं वो बड़े स्ट्रक्चरल नोयत के हैं, क्योंकि वहाँ पे जो डिविजन्स हैं वो एथनिक लाइंस पर, सेक्टेरियन लाइंस पर, आइडियोलॉजिकल लाइंस पर, अर्बन रूरल लाइंस पर काफ़ी पुराने हैं। जिन सोसाइटीज़ में ऐसे प्रॉब्लम होते हैं वहाँ ग्रेजुअली इंस्टीट्यूशन डेवलप होती हैं, पार्लियामेंट्री सिस्टम डेवलप होता है, इलेक्शंस होते हैं, जहाँ ये इन चीज़ों की इंटेंसिटी को मॉडरेट करके को एग्जिस्ट किया जाता है। अनफॉर्चुनेटली अफगानिस्तान में वो इंस्टीट्यूशंस डेवलप नहीं हुए। जब ऐसा हो तो फिर क्या होता है, फिर वॉर लॉर्ड एक दूसरे से लड़ते हैं और फैसला जो है वो बंदूक से ही होता है, उससे नहीं होता। और इसी तरीके से पहले भी यही हुआ कि बंदूक के ज़ोर पे एक हुकूमत आई, फिर जिस तरह अमरीका आया और इन्हें भी बंदूक के ज़ोर पे उनको निकाला और कब्जा किया। तो ये जो चीज़ें हैं कि उनके यहाँ किस तरीके से अकामोडेट किया जाए, सो कॉल्ड इंक्लूसिव गवर्नमेंट बनाई जाए, इसमें मसाइल हैं, क्योंकि अभी तक जो पश्तून और नान पश्तून के सिर्फ मसला नहीं है, जो वहाँ पे अब जो सो कॉल्ड लिबरल एलिमेंट्स हैं वो ज़्यादातर नान पश्तून हैं, और उनके लिए तालिबान का जो रिजिड रूल है उसको कबूल करना, आप खुद सोचें कि हमारे यहाँ अगर TTP की हुकूमत आ जाए तो हम सब क्या कहेंगे, तो वो मजमूरी तौर पर इस मामले में काफ़ी परेशान है। तो सिर्फ उनको ये कहने से कि आप इनको और वो अगर उनको अकामोडेट करेंगे तो वो अंदर से सब वर्सन नहीं करेंगे, क्योंकि दुश्मनी तो है, इख्तलाफ तो है, इसलिए ये एक स्लो प्रोसेस होगा। और इसीलिए उन्होंने अभी तक अपनी सो कॉल्ड इंक्लूसिव गवर्नमेंट में वाजबी तौर पर एक दो ताजिक्स को उनको किया है, लेकिन जो सब्सटेंशियल ताजिक्स हैं वो अभी जो लेवल ऑफ ट्रस्ट है वो इतना नहीं है कि वो उनको अकोमोडेट करें। तो ये प्रोसेस जो है ये अल्टीमेटली जो इंस्टीट्यूशनल डेवलपमेंट है अफगानिस्तान की वो अगर शुरू होगी, और अल्टीमेटली तो वोटों ने फैसला करना है, अगर आपने सिर्फ नॉमिनेटिव गवर्नमेंट को लाना है और उससे करना है तो उतना तो नहीं हो सकता। तो ये ख्वाहिश तो बहुत अच्छी भी है और ज़रूरी भी है, लेकिन इसका प्रोसेस जो है वो लॉन्ग टर्म होगा। इसी तरीके से जो आपका इकनॉमिक मैनेजमेंट के लिए लाना प्रोफेशनल्स को, दिल मोस्टली भी नान पश्तून, और वो उन पे भी ट्रस्ट करना जो है वो ज़रा मुश्किल होता है। तो मेरा ख्याल है कि इसमें और पाकिस्तान का जो रोल था इन ट्राइंग टू गाइड देम एंड गिविंग देम इवन एक्सपर्टीज, वो अनफॉर्चुनेटली वेस्टर्न वर्ल्ड ने ब्लेम गेम में हमें थोड़ा सा वो कर दिया, स्लो डाउन कर दिया कि आप उनके वो पहले भी नंबर जबरदार थे, अब भी उनकी रफ्तारी कर रहे हैं, लेकिन मेरा ख्याल है कि क्वाइटली भी वी आर रेडी टू गिव देम एक्सपर्ट्स एंड गिव देम एडवाइस, क्योंकि इस वक्त बाहर की एडवाइस जो है वो ज़्यादा कामयाब होगी बजाय उसके अपने अंदर के इख्तलाफात। और तीसरी चीज़ जो है कि सोशल तरीके से, ये सिर्फ नया आइन बनाने की बात नहीं है, आइन पे अमल कौन करेगा, बेसिकली तालिबान ने फैसला करना है कि उनका जो निज़ाम है, शुराई निज़ाम है, किस तरह का निज़ाम है, हुकूमत उनकी कैसे चलेगी, जो आइन बनाएंगे जब वो, तो वो मॉनार्की तो नहीं चल सकती ना जो ज़ाहिर शाह की थी, इसमें उन्हें कुछ ना कुछ रास्ता ढूंढना पड़ेगा। तो ये सारे लॉन्ग टर्म इश्यूज़ हैं, इम्पॉर्टेंट इशूज़ हैं, लेट्स होप। और इसीलिए ये जो उनका दे लाइक टू प्रमोट ट्रेड एंड बेनिफिट फ्रॉम इट, लेकिन सवाल ये है कि इंसर्जेंसी अब क्या होगा, जो जो उनके एंटी तालिबान लोग हैं वो कब उनको, बल्कि लोग बातें कर रहे हैं कि वेस्टर्न वर्ल्ड उनकी मदद करे, और इसलिए ये एक काफ़ी बड़ा मसला।
बिल्कुल सही कहा डॉक्टर साहब, सरताज अजीज साहब की बात जो है उसमें काफ़ी काफ़ी से ज़्यादा वजन है, वेरी लॉजिकल। डॉक्टर साहब आप कुछ कहना चाहेंगे आपके साथ?
नहीं, मैं अभी मैं कंप्लीटली एग्री करता हूँ, और मेरा ख्याल है कि आई डोंट हैव कमेंट्स एट द मोमेंट।
अच्छा, ओके। डॉक्टर हसना, आपका कोई कमेंट है या कुछ आप पूछना चाहते हैं?
मैं जाके अभी अपनी जो एक प्रेजेंटेशन है या जो भी मेरी एक मुद्दा है उसमें इंशाल्लाह मैं वाज़ेह कर दूंगा कि मेरी क्या रिक्वायरमेंट है।
जी जी बेहतर, जरूर। हाँ, ओवर टू यू।
थैंक यू सो मच, थैंक यू। ओके, सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल वंस अगेन आई वांट टू से दैट थैंक यू सो मच फॉर इनवाइटिंग यू हियर, एंड एज डॉक्टर अगदस मेंशनड दैट इट्स अ ग्रेट अपॉर्चुनिटी टू शेयर अ पैनल विद सच अ लेजेंडरी पर्सनालिटी. Sartaj Aziz Saab is over here. So we have definitely, we learned a lot of things when we were growing up from him, from his presence around us in the newspapers, in the news, etc. All these things we have seen. So what I can present over here about current political situation and emerging economic prospects for Afghanistan and the region. I'm coming up with, Sartaj Saab mentioned that there's a great history of Afghanistan, but I will focus only on the last 20 years, because what we have seen, Afghanistan changed from traditional economy to a free market economy after US invasion and the war on terror. We entered a new phase where US government injected a lot of money, controlled the budgets, supported the army. All these things have been done. But our situation is this, that what we are looking forward now, I'm coming up with three possible scenarios in this regard, which can be possible, because I'm not coming up with some suggestion at the moment. I'm rather going to discuss only the three possible scenarios which can happen and how we can react to these scenarios. The first scenario is a very ideal scenario, which I can call it optimistic scenario. And in this optimistic scenario, what can happen? A simple Afghan Taliban is going to be recognized by the world community, and then they can have very good relationship with the rest of the world, which is likely impossible in current scenario, because that the humiliated defeat of US in Afghanistan, they definitely need scapegoats, and they're not going to accept Taliban so easily. And beside this, they have local, national, political imperatives. Why? Because if they are going to accept Taliban so quickly, so the local political setup, as we can see, Biden rating already decreased to historical low, so they are not going to accept Taliban in the short run. Although I consider that would have been a best possible scenario for rest of the world, for neighboring countries in Afghanistan, around Afghanistan, that is a ideal situation, optimistic situation. But as we know that this is not going to happen so easily. Why? Because the current situation, as I discussed with you, is not in favor of accepting Taliban or integrating Taliban into the world economy or world politics. That is not a good one. The second scenario, which I present over here, and later on I will talk about their economic repercussions on Pakistan and on the region, is the optimistic pessimistic scenario. There is a possibility that Afghan Taliban are not accepted, but Afghan Taliban find out a way, like what North Korea, what Cuba, what China from 1949 to 1978 found a way how to build their own resilience within the country, within the borders, and integrate the local economy. I know the Afghan has a great history and very rich history, but we don't know in the known history whether they have integrated the whole region under one government or not. Always there are ethnic groups who were trying to fight against each other. So there is a always like a optimistic, pessimistic situation where the Afghan government is trying to control and impose some rules on the country. And that is in the form of new constitutions or in the form of building institutions. We discussed earlier, Madam Samina Khalil mentioned that institutions are very important for development of a country. Basic problem with Afghanistan and in this region with many countries is in developed institutions, strong and resilient institutions. So that will be a kind of opportunity for Afghan Taliban that despite no recognition globally, they still will develop some institution, given that they have good infrastructure now. Because when US government left, when U.S. government left, they left a very good institution infrastructure for Afghan Taliban. We can see they have good buildings, they have good furniture, and they have SUVs. They have number of things which Afghan Taliban could not manage without the last 20 years of U.S. debt rule of Ghani and Hamid Karzai. So now they are in a better position to develop those institutions based on given infrastructure. Then local economy mobilized, because it is not always you are looking outside for help, despite the fact there are a number of problems like we can see in Iran, but what they are doing to mobilize the local economy. Sometimes you have to feed nationalistic sentiments, which Afghan has abundant nationalistic sentiments, so they can utilize it for the positive reasons and then they can mobilize the local economy. We must keep in mind that Taliban are really good in terms of cost-benefit analysis and the way they are spending money, because they are very economical. Their total one-year revenue, annual revenue, were $400 million. And they were fighting a war with a superpower who was putting and injecting billions and trillions of dollars in this war. And they defeated this with $400 million per annum, which is a very current figure. Probably in the beginning, Afghan Taliban did not have much of that. So it means that economically they know how to use and how to put money in those places. Then they don't need to pay to expensive consultants. Two of my co-panelists, they mentioned that most of the money, if 50% of the money was going outside. Why? Because those warlords, those officials, corrupt officials, their stake was not in Kabul. If their stake was in Kabul and if their money was in Kabul, Kabul debacle could not have happened overnight. It could take probably 4 to 5 to 6 months, which Americans have calculated. I think they were quite rational, but they did not know that most of the people, and particularly those officials, they put all their assets abroad, their kids were abroad, etc. So these things played a very huge role in the Kabul debacle. So in this optimistic, pessimistic scenario, what we can see, they do not need to spend too much money on expensive consultant, and they can tackle with corruption. Afghan Taliban can increase internal resources because now, though economically they are under pressure, but one thing is for sure that they brought peace and stability to some extent. If you go to far-flung areas, the war is over, people are under pressure because Taliban rule is there. But one thing, because they were paying huge financial and other costs, and now they are not going to pay that. So the people can mobilize within Afghanistan, can move from one province to another province, and can collaborate in businesses from one part to another. Local connectivity can be increased if they give it a chance. So now private investment, local private investment can be mobilized. Similarly, regional powers in this case, in this scenario, if international community, the West particularly, is not going to accept Taliban, so what Taliban can do, they can go to SCO, they can go to OIC, and they can use that SAR platform these platforms they can use to build connectivity initially. And later on, once they develop a trust and they show their commitment to the rest of the world, then slowly and gradually they come on the global scene and they can do more things. Lastly, this is my scenarios. Later on, I'm coming to see what kind of impact they will have on the Afghan economy and regional economy. Is a pessimistic scenario. There is a pessimistic scenario in the sense that Taliban can go again for a kind of civil war. Why? Because currently 20 provinces are under Akani's rule and remaining provinces are under Mullah Brothers, those allies rule. So they are a kind of fraction is there. But if with the passage of time, this fractions, this fissure is going to be greater, they will create huge problem and then they will go to civil war. And in this case, what will happen, that is pessimistic scenario, is exploitative economy will give way to people will try to exploit things. They will not produce anything. Production will stop. Whatever little production is there in Afghanistan, that will not be materialized. So internal conflict on resources in absence of institution, that will be another problem. Because many of the warlords, they want to show their personal power and the things. So what we in the beginning discussed, that if there are strong institutions, the rule of law will be implemented. Otherwise, if personalities are going to rule and they are going to follow cults, so then it can create problems. And in pessimistic scenario, that will be one of the biggest problem. What will happen, I think some of my co-panelists, they mentioned this, that hotbed for terrorism. In the pessimistic scenario, Afghanistan will be a nurturing place for terrorists once again. And rest of the world is not going to is going to feed the brunt of this terrorist organizations or terrorism from Afghanistan. There's a high possibility if there is a pessimistic approach, if there is a pessimistic scenario, if rest of the world is not accepting Afghanistan and Afghanistan is collapsed from within inside, and that will give way for a hotbed for terrorists. And they will come and then they will join the ranks and files of Taliban and will try to do something which will affect rest of the world. Liquidity crunch will come definitely when you are going to be under sanction and your trade is less, your exports are far less than your imports. You are exporting something $700 million worth of goods and services and importing a $7 billion worth of goods and services. So there is a huge trade deficit and you have to somehow look into this. Moreover, if they are not going to deal with the rest of the world, they will not have dollars, their banking system will collapse, there will be run on the banks, panic will create, and it will give way to a very classical phenomenon, which we call that internal displacement. That internal displacement will give way for refugees and humanitarian crisis in Afghanistan, which nobody will control. And because Afghanistan at a moment is 39 million people, and those 39 million people where the 75% of population is under 25. So definitely they will prefer to go to other countries. The situation will compel them. And that humanitarian crisis will not be felt by Afghanistan, neighbors Iran and Pakistan. But the knock can be heard even at the borders of Europe. And Europe is already under pressure. Their domestic political imperatives are compelling them not to receive further refugees from any country after Syria and some of the refugees went there in the last few years. So this will create a problem. Now, we are looking into current situation and then we are going to see what will be the economic impact. In current situation, if we look 1 million Afghan civil and armed forces are jobless at the moment. As Dr. Agadas rightly mentioned, that those people were earning money and then they were spending money. Afghan GDP, 82% of Afghan GDP was coming from consumption, household consumption. So they were the major contributor to Afghan GDP, whatever GDP they had. Now, what happened when they are jobless, the poverty rate increased from 50% to 60%. And it's going to further increase because inflation is going up. A rapid inflation, rampant inflation is, I talked to one of my friend yesterday, just for the reason that I'm going to have some information for today. So he told me that oil price, cooking oil price for 16 kg tin increased from 1800 Afghanis, almost 3600 Pakistani rupees, to 2600 Afghanis, 5200 rupees. Flour has increased 35%. Similarly, other items has increased more than 30 to 35%, and that is the availability now. What will happen if the availability stops? Because most of the things currently, like flour, is coming from Tajikistan. So in the winter, that area will get blocked. Transportation is not very easy. This will create a kind of problem. This is current situation. A trained people, Sathajis have mentioned, left country. Just look back, 20 years they spent on education, 10 years they spent on gaining some experience, and finally they boarded a plane C-130 and went to New York or some other areas in Qatar or Pakistan. Mm-hmm. So this is a huge brain drain of hundreds of thousands of people, will create a huge gap for Afghan Taliban and for Afghan government to recover from. So liquidity crisis is coming already there, because currently you can withdraw 20,000 Afghanis or $200 per week, which is not sufficient for the people and families, because Afghan families are usually very large families. They're living together. At the same time, governance is a big issue in Afghanistan currently. Most of these mullahs and most of these scholars, religious scholars, they come and try to occupy the good position of database and other offices. They don't know any database. They don't have any experience. So when you put somebody there, and currently the Afghan education minister issued a statement, he said that whoever received education in the last 20 years, that is redundant. So that is useless. Now you can imagine this statement, how much it will cost Afghan people. Why? Because they will not produce any learned person in terms of the modern economy or politics. So these are the things which are currently going on in Afghanistan. If we look into currently any program for Afghan rehabilitation after getting Kabul, we did not hear any program from Afghan Taliban. That is creating a kind of frustration within Afghan, and even outside Afghanistan, frustration is there. So now I'm coming to the scenarios. I discussed three scenarios: pessimistic, optimistic, and finally pessimistic scenarios. I'm going to see the repercussion on the region and on the world economy. If Afghanistan is accepted, then neighbors will be happy. They will have a wonderful a missing link in the region, as ma'am you mentioned in the beginning, that Afghanistan, despite the fact with 2% population and less than 1% GDP of this region, is very, very important geographically, because it's going to connect us to Central Asia, to Iran, to West Asia, to other part of the world, and we will have a peaceful feeling if Afghanistan is at peace. Same is the case for China, as I'm working in China, so I'm just going to share and mention that China is really happy to be a part in rehabilitation of Afghanistan, but they are not very much enthusiastic about it at the moment, because China is engaged on the South China front. And in 2023, China is going to re-elect the president. So Xi Jinping definitely is going to be a strong contender again. And therefore, they are much more focused on the local issues at the moment. There is a number of political issues within the country, like how to control big giant these tech industries and other things. So they are much more consumed domestically. They don't have that much power stamina for Afghanistan at the moment. And they are very good in history. Remember this thing. Because in Chinese, they are saying that which means that whenever you are crossing the river, touch the stones. And that meaning is very clear in their approach toward things. They are not going to come to fill the vacuum in Afghanistan very quickly. Rather, they will wait, will see, and will try to do that from a distance. Because in the recent history, what happened in Afghanistan to superpower, China is not going to take any misstep which will cause them a lot. So this is in the first case scenario, China will be really happy if the world accept Taliban and they join Taliban and rehabilitation is there. China will have a very prosperous and peaceful neighboring country. CPAC will go through it. China is looking forward for this opportunity. The whole region will benefit. We have a strong cultural connectivity with Central Asia. But what we are lacking is no economic connectivity with Central Asia. And the reason is that a peaceful Afghanistan is must for that. In the last 40 years, Afghanistan is not at peace. And we miss the links with Central Asia. We miss the economic opportunities with Central Asia. So if Afghanistan is at peace, that will be a very good situation. Some good points in the first scenario, optimistic scenario, that Afghanistan government will be accepted are like a few points. Western Union got green signal from the American government, and then they will start working there. Yesterday, EU leader Ursula war deadline, they announced 1 billion humanitarian aid, as Sataj Aziz have mentioned, that aid will go through NGOs, but at least they know that the severity of the Afghan situation, slowly and gradually they will move, but they are at a moment in a very in a defeat mode, so they are not going to rush for that. They will take little time, but international community somehow is working on it. Now, if we come to the second scenario, that Afghanistan Taliban are capable enough to build their own institution on the basis of whatever, if Sharia law, if local 1962 or Zahir Shah constitutions, whatever, but they will contain this crisis to Afghan borders and then they will manage to develop institution. In second scenario, that will be really good for the neighboring countries because they will buy time how to deal and tackle with Afghan crisis. Similarly, rest of the world will look into the commitments of Afghanistan, Taliban, whether they are going to follow the rules or international-like standards or not. So they will have some time in the optimistic, pessimistic scenario. Finally, in pessimistic scenario, what will happen, I discussed to some extent, that refugees influx, humanitarian crisis, a very big-like issue for the neighboring countries and for rest of the world. As a known quote from Dr. Mehbubul Haq, that poverty anywhere is a threat to prosperity everywhere. That will be a textbook case of Afghanistan because they will become a threat to prosperity anywhere. Terrorists will groom in that place. If nobody is accepting Taliban and the warlord create a kind of civil war, then line order situation will burst and proxy wars will start and unending war will lead us to nowhere. That is a way. Now, what we can do, I don't have a clear policy suggestion for that because Afghanistan issue is a very complicated issue. But whatever we want to do is we need to mitigate the risk proactively, with proactive approaches. Now, some of the countries are doing really well in this regard, who has some sort of like political capital in the rest of the world, like Qatar. The foreign minister of Qatar yesterday gave a statement that we should look at an Afghan issue. So I personally think that those countries, neighboring countries, they first need to agree on something like China, Tajikistan, Iran, Pakistan. If they come together, Pakistan, Iran, and other like Muslim countries, they have a very good platform, which is not very effective, we know, but at least in case of Afghanistan, they can do something from the platform of OIC. And similarly, if China work with the with Pakistan, work with China and Russia, so then they can use the SEO platform to somehow bring Taliban online and tackle those crises, those issues. So these are my perspectives, three different scenarios, three different impacts. I wish we have optimistic scenario in Afghanistan. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Hasnaz. Thank you so much for a very, very comprehensive and very, very visionary kind of discourse that you have explained everything in three scenarios. I think that was wonderful. First, I'd like Sardar Aziz Sahib, if you have any comment on what Dr. Hasnath has said.
Well, I think let's hope if the, at least the middle scenario rather than optimistic.
Because I agree with you.
there is great scope for self-reliance strategies if you are not getting aid from outside, and mobilizing local resources and mobilizing local investment, as well as, you know, trying to distribute. And I think one point that has not come up is that under Taliban, at least corruption is minimal, and the waste of resources that was taking place.
Very important point. Yes.
Therefore, to that extent, they can, if they are given peace, at least not disturbed, you know, from outside forces getting support, they could follow, and most likely that's what they will do. But then the more difficult question will be if they can somehow manage to retain professionals to manage the local economy, at least, and incentives for work. And this will require some flexibility in dealing with non-Pashtun communities, Tajiks and Uzbeks, and particularly, you know, using universities where a large number of these young people work to give them job opportunities wherever possible. And I think on the whole, if the world would not take a very active role in destroying the Taliban regime, they will probably follow the middle option. And if enough regional countries come together and recognize them and start giving them assistance and investment possibilities, then this middle scenario will work. So that is my hope.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Dr. Abdus Saab, are you going to comment on something?
जी बस बहुत अच्छा एनालिसिस प्रेजेंट किया हसनाथ डॉक्टर हसनाथ ने वेरी वेरी कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव स्पेशली विद द थ्री सिनेरियोस मैं बस एक बात ये कहना चाहूँगा एंड आई हैव हर्ड दिस इन अदर प्लेसेस एज वेल आई थिंक आई वुडंट गो सो फार एज टू से दैट देयर हैज बीन अ डिफीट टू द यूएस इन अफगानिस्तान पर से I seem to have this feeling that it is more of a strategic reset, you know, क्योंकि जो अमेरिका की फॉरेन पॉलिसी एस्टेब्लिशमेंट है उसमें कुछ अरसे से ये बात की जा रही थी कि the real problem is China and that they should somehow get out of Afghanistan to focus on South China Sea के अंदर जो developments हो रही हैं वहाँ पर तीन बड़ी economies हैं Taiwan, Philippines, चार इकोनॉमीज ताइवान फिलीपींस साउथ कोरिया एंड जापान तो वो है चीज़ जिसको मेरा ख्याल में जिसकी तरफ अमेरिका का अब फोकस है एक बड़ा अच्छा कॉलम आया था एक बड़ा अच्छे लिखने वाले एडम टूज उसने ये कुछ फिगर्स दे करके बताया कि काइंड ऑफ इन्वेस्टमेंट दैट अमेरिका इज़ नाउ मेकिंग इन टू इट्स डिफेंस प्रोक्योरमेंट और डिफेंस बजट इज एक्चुअली गोइंग अप नॉट डाउन So it wasn't really an issue of the fact that they didn't have the money. It seems to be the case that there is a strategic reset towards China. And uske repercussions bhi hamare country ke liye hamare khitte mein bahut zyada honge. Kyunki aapko pata hai ki hamara ek hamsaya mulk hai jisko western countries prop up kar rahi hain as a counter to China. To aage chalke in dono mumalik ke darmiyan kis kisam ka ek सेटलमेंट होता है या नहीं हो पाता तो उसके भी रिपरकशंस होंगे बट अगेन आई थिंक दैट दिस इज अ वेरी इंटेंशनल एंड द फैक्ट दैट दे हैव पुल्ड आउट ऑफ अफगानिस्तान इज नॉट अ डिफीट बट इट डेफिनेटली कुड हैव बीन मैनेज्ड बेटर फॉर बेटर ऑप्टिक्स
ओके सर थैंक यू सो मच डॉक्टर हसनाथ मैं थोड़ा सा आपसे ये बात करना चाह रही थी कि सिंस आई नो दैट यू हैव worked a lot on CPAC and I have always been very optimistic about the future of CPAC and still am very very much optimistic about it and the initiative of Chinese government about this Belt and Road Initiative actually. Since you are very well versed in not only you do the research work also you have established a center of CPAC in your university in Jilin University China and also you teach the subject as well. I'm just curious about it that what do you think that Chinese are, if not today, if not in near future, maybe in future, they would be interested in Afghanistan, engaging Afghanistan in this mega project of Belt and Road. and how is it going to be? I mean, you must have some impressions about it.
Yes, ma'am. First of all, is this that Afghanistan has a lot of mineral resources, but your study is showing that Pentagon and Geological Service showing that more than $1 trillion of mineral resources are available in Afghanistan. And in some cases, even in the Chicago tribe, they are saying that more than $2 trillion of mineral resources are available. So Chinese economy, Chinese companies, Chinese like people, they will definitely be interested. But beside economic perspective, China is also interested in terms of connectivity, because that is an area of influence. You need to increase your area of influence. China on the coastal side is not that much like South China Sea that is disputed. Vietnam, Korea, Japan, Philippines, those Taiwan issues there. On the other side, Mongolia is like a buffer zone still after such a long time. Central Asia itself is under the influence and control of Russia. So China definitely needs some sort of a kind of strategic depth, like one we have in Pakistan, which is unfortunately not paying a lot, a kind of like influence in the country. So Afghanistan, definitely China is looking for that. If there were no mineral resources, China would have been interested in Afghanistan. Beside this, two important routes are going nearby Afghanistan. One is Western Corridor or Belt and Road Initiative, and another is CPEC. So for both of them, that is very important. And if you look at that, if you want to connect Western Corridor with South Asia, so Afghanistan is the only like a cog. Afghanistan, peaceful Afghanistan, will bring these two corridors to connect with each other. So that will be really a huge influence, economic benefit for Afghanistan, for China. And they are really interested in it. But as I mentioned, China is always waiting for the right moment, and they are very much cautious, particularly in terms of about Afghanistan. Because in Afghanistan, what happened to USSR, what happened to United States and allies, China really want to find a new way how to enter Afghanistan. So China is interested, but is cautious.
Okay. Dr. Agdas, would you like to say something?
Okay, very briefly, मुझे पता है कि हमारा वक्त बहुत हो गया है. मैं एक बात कहना चाहता हूँ और मैं इस चीज़ का फ़ायदा उठाना चाह रहा हूँ कि हमारे पास सरकार साहब बैठे हुए हैं, डॉक्टर हसनात एज अ स्कॉलर ऑन सीपैक. तो ये मैंने अक्सर फील किया, मैं देखना चाहता था कि आप लोग इसके बारे में कैसे सोचते हैं. मैं ये समझता हूँ कि बात तो हम अफगानिस्तान के ऊपर कर रहे हैं, लेकिन चाइना के ऊपर बात एक तरह से टेंजेंशियली शुरू हुई. तो मैं ये समझता हूँ कि चाइना के साथ जो पाकिस्तान की एंगेजमेंट है, आई थिंक उसको भी बड़े गौर से देखने की ज़रूरत है, क्योंकि कुछ बहुत ही इंटरेस्टिंग किस्म के चेंजेस आ रहे हैं. हम बेसिकली शुरू हुए हैं डिफेंस कोलैबोरेशन के साथ, मतलब वो जो उनका इंटरनेशनल जीपीएस सिस्टम है, ओनली कंट्री जिसको उन्होंने अलाउ किया है अपने वो जीपीएस इंफॉर्मेशन, वो पाकिस्तान है. तो हमें द काइंड ऑफ कोलैबोरेशन दैट वी हैव विद चाइना इज रियली प्रीटी स्पेक्टेकुलर, नंबर वन. तो ये देख रहा हूँ कि वहाँ से फिर चीज़ें चली हैं, और फिर हाल ही में चाइना के इकोनॉमिक मॉडल के ऊपर बहुत सी बात होना शुरू हो गई है पाकिस्तान के अंदर. यू नो हाउ चाइना हैज़ you know basically lifted about different figure aa rahe hain 80 crore 90 crore people out of poverty, jo ke human civilization ya human history mein pehle kabhi nahi hua hai. So definitely China is being touted as a model for success, but I think we need to be very very careful here, kyunki yahan se jo aage ka safar hai that could be a very very slippery slope, kyunki aap ye dekhein एक नेचुरल इसकी प्रोग्रेशन है कि इकोनॉमिक मॉडल से बात करते करते आप पॉलिटिकल मॉडल ऑफ चाइना की बात करना शुरू कर देंगे, विच और ये कुछ लोग पीपल को डिसएग्री, बट चाइना बाय नो मींस इज अ डेमोक्रेसी. यू नो इट इज अ वन पार्टी स्टेट, जो कि चाइना के अंदर तो जिसकी जो चल गई है बिकॉज ऑफ वहाँ पे मेजॉरिटी हान चाइनीज की है. लेकिन पाकिस्तान, जैसे कि सरकार से ने बात की थी अफगानिस्तान के हवाले से, आई थिंक पाकिस्तान में भी बहुत से क्रॉस कटिंग क्लीवेजेस और फॉल्ट लाइंस हैं, रिलीजन की, एथनिसिटी की, लिंग्विस्टिक, नॉर्थ एंड साउथ east and west, so on and so forth. So I think we need to be very, very careful in our association with China. Because if you have politically tried to synchronize with them, then next step is social model of China, which is a very dangerous situation. जिसके अंदर पर हम बात करेंगे कंप्लीट एंड टोटल कंट्रोल ऑफ सोसाइटी. जैसे अभी हाल ही में आपने देखा है कि चाइना में एक एनर्जी क्राइसिस आया हुआ है नॉर्थ एरियाज के अंदर, तो उनकी गवर्नमेंट ने ऑर्डर किया और तमाम एलिवेटर्स बंद हो गए हैं उस एरिया के अंदर. नोबडी इज अलाउड टू यूज एलिवेटर्स. कुछ साल पहले उन्होंने ऑर्डर किया तमाम डॉक्टर्स को स्मोकिंग छोड़नी पड़ गई. और फिर अगेन जो वन चाइल्ड पॉलिसी थी चाइना की, तो मैं सिर्फ ये अर्ज कर रहा हूँ कि हमारा एक बहुत ही इंटरेस्टिंग एंगेजमेंट है चाइना के साथ, बट आवर पॉलिसी मेकर्स हैव टू बी वेरी वेरी केयरफुल कि ये इकोनॉमिक्स से आगे का जो सफर है पॉलिटिक्स और सोशल का, वो दैट कुड बी अ वेरी डेंजरस पाथ. क्योंकि उसको पाकिस्तान में बहुत से मसाइल पैदा हो जाएंगे अगर हमने ये जो हमारा डेमोक्रेसी का एक्सपेरिमेंट है या डेमोक्रेसी का जो हमारे पास एक इंस्टीट्यूशन है इसको बंद करने की कोशिश की.
China has been my subject of great interest, and I was lucky to visit China first time in December 67 during the Cultural Revolution. And in my diary I wrote when I came back to Dhaka on the 24th, 22nd of December, that these 10 days I spent in China would have greater impact on my thinking on development and life than any other 10 days. So then I began to study it in greater depth. And in 73, then I again visited, then 74, then 75. So then in 76, I decided to write a book on China. It's called, I spent 2 months in Sussex Institute of Development Studies and wrote Rural Development Learning from China. And वहाँ पे यही जो बात कर रहे हैं, Dr. Afzal, how can we learn from China? उसमें China का comprehensive model describe किया rural development का, उसमें कौन-कौन से part elements हैं, इंटरमीडिएट मॉडल कौन सा है और पार्शियल मॉडल कौन सा है, कि किस अगर आपकी पॉलिटिकल रिक्वायरमेंट्स और वो रिक्वायरमेंट कैसे हैं इन टर्म्स ऑफ रूरल डेवलपमेंट ओनली नॉट इन अदर टर्म्स. एंड सो दैट पर्टिकुलर टाइपोलॉजी इज स्टिल रेलेवेंट. उसके बाद जाहिर है कि चाइना के जो लेसन्स हैं वो ज़रूरी नहीं है कि आप उनका पूरा मॉडल फॉलो करें. उनका जो पॉवर्टी का मॉडल है उसमें जाहिर है कि स्टार्टेड विद बेसिक लैंड रिफॉर्म्स एंड देन कलेक्टिवाइजेशन एंड देन डाइवर्सिफिकेशन. वो मेरे जो उसको उसने ऑक्सफोर्ड यूनिवर्सिटी ने अजीज मॉडल ऑफ रूरल डेवलपमेंट कैप पे उस पर काफ़ी सेमिनार्स करवाए कि हाउ फार इट इज़ रेलिवेंट. तो वो आई एग्री कि हमें उसको इतना एक्सटेंड नहीं करना चाहिए. लेकिन उसके बाद चाइना से हमारे रिलेशनशिप हैं वो बड़े सिंसियर और बड़े अच्छे हैं. और पिछले जो गवर्नमेंट आई जैसी भी तब्दीली आई वो रिलेशनशिप ख़राब नहीं. लेकिन 2015 में जो उनका सीपैक वाला फ्लैगशिप था उसके बाद उसमें एक बड़ी क्वालिटेटिव स्ट्रेटेजिक चेंज आया. क्योंकि चाइना के लिए ये जो बेल्ट एंड रोड इनिशिएटिव है ये बहुत ज़रूरी है. क्योंकि चाइना इज लैंड लॉक फ्रॉम थ्री साइड्स और उसमें जो उनका वेस्टर्न चाइना है ख़ासतौर पर सिंकियांग वगैरह, वो वहाँ जाने के लिए आपको 10-11 हज़ार किलोमीटर जाके साउथ चाइना सी के साथ शंघाई पहुँचते हैं, फिर 4-5 हज़ार किलोमीटर अंदर आते हैं और वहाँ से गवर्नर इज ओनली 3,400 किलोमीटर की और बड़ी आसानी से आप वहाँ से आ सकते हैं. तो चाइना की ओपनिंग के लिए ये जो सी पैक है इट्स ए ग्रेट अपॉर्चुनिटी. और इसलिए वो मुझे याद है कि हमारी पहली विजिट में देवर डिस्कस हाईवे कि ये अभी तक आपने हमारी तरफ से बन गया, आपकी तरफ से नहीं बना. वी आर नॉट रेडी फॉर डिस्कशन पर मैंने फ़ोन किया तो उन्होंने कहा जी उनसे कहें हमारा भी बना ले. तो देन दे बिल्ट अबाउट 30 माइल्स ऑफ आर साइड बिकॉज आर लेबर कुड नॉट वर्क एट 16,000 फीट. सो दैट्स हाउ कराकोरम हाईवे वाज द फर्स्ट कनेक्टिविटी बिटवीन दैट चाइना. सो फ्रॉम देयर फॉर देम इट्स. लेकिन मैंने जो फॉरेन ऑफिस में देखा कि द फैक्ट टू हैव ए सिंसियर फ्रेंड लाइक चाइना वॉज ए ग्रेट सोर्स ऑफ सेटिस्फेक्शन. किसी इशू पर हमें ज़रूरत होगी, जिस तरह हमने भी उनकी मदद की उन्होंने भी हमारी मदद की. इस वक्त फॉरेन पॉलिसी एरिया में वी डोंट हैव ए मोर रिलायबल फ्रेंड देन चाइना. और इसीलिए आप इकोनॉमिक एक्टिविटी भी हमारी, आपको याद है कि अगर ये 60-50-60 बिलियन डॉलर 10 साल में भी खर्च हो और हर साल 4-5 बिलियन डॉलर खर्च हो, ये कितना बड़ा. ऐसे वक्त में तो हमें कोई $1 बिलियन देने को तैयार नहीं है. खासतौर से आई एम अब देता तो कितनी शर्ती करते हैं, तो ये रिलेशनशिप इज गोइंग वेल. ये जो बातें होती हैं कि उनका मॉडल सीख के हम पॉवर्टी हल कर देंगे और ये कर देंगे, दिस आई थिंक इज जस्ट विशफुल थिंकिंग आई वुड कॉल इट. बट एक्चुअली जो उनसे टेक्नोलॉजी लर्न कर सकते हैं, आर्टिफिशियल इंटेलिजेंस लर्न कर सकते हैं, एग्रीकल्चर में जो उनके एक्सपीरियंस है उनसे लर्न कर सकते हैं. सो वी हैव टू बी वेरी सिलेक्टिव. और हमारे यहाँ अब थिंक टैंक्स का भी कोऑपरेशन हो रहा है और हमारे यहाँ यूनिवर्सिटी का भी कोऑपरेशन हो रहा है, और वहाँ पे मेरा ख्याल है कि बड़ी रियलिस्टिक कोऑपरेशन होगी. एंड वी शुड तो मेरा टाइम खत्म हो गया जी.
बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया सर, थैंक यू सो मच.
अगर इजाज़त दें मैं सर ताजदीद साहब को इंडोर्स करने की कोशिश यहाँ पे इस तरीके से करूँगा कि अब चाइना में भी एक प्रैग्मेटिक अप्रोच है. चाइना में चाहे जो भी सिचुएशन हो वो बाहर से लर्न करते हैं. इन द लास्ट 20-30 इयर्स दे लर्न अ लॉट फ्रॉम द वेस्ट डिस्पाइट द फैक्ट दे आर अ कम्युनिस्ट सोसाइटी, लेकिन वो उस हवाले से बड़े ओपन थे, बड़े प्रैग्मेटिक रहे हैं. तो एक तो ये चीज़ है कि अगर हम प्रैग्मेटिकली चीज़ों को देखें और उनसे लर्न करें और उनको इम्प्लीमेंट करें इन ट्रू स्पिरिट्स और यहाँ पे हम मसाइल हल करें तो अच्छी बात है. म्यूचुअल लर्निंग का एक जो प्रोसेस है वो चलता रहे वो बड़ी अच्छी बात. अब चाइना में बुनियादी तौर पे ये जिस तरह से 700 to 800 million पॉपुलेशन उनकी पावर्टी लाइन से जो है ऊपर गई है, ये बहुत बड़ी अचीवमेंट है. अब उसके लिए जो पॉलिसीज उन्होंने इख्तियार की वो एग्रीकल्चर से ही शुरू की. 1978 में डेंग शाओपिंग ने सबसे पहले जो रिफॉर्म्स आए वो एग्रीकल्चर बेस्ड रिफॉर्म थे. इंडस्ट्री को बाद में उन्होंने थोड़ा टाइम दिया, तो स्लोली एंड ग्रेजुअली उन्होंने मोमेंटम डेवलप किया और इंडस्ट्री के लिए जितना लेबर था वो रिफॉर्म्स एग्रीकल्चर रिफॉर्म्स के बाद इंडस्ट्री के लिए वो लेबर जो सरप्लस लेबर था उन्होंने वो मुहैया किया. तो एक तो ये चीज़ है कि हमें थोड़ा सा लर्निंग के लिए वो एक जाविया ओपन रखना है. दूसरी बात ये कि चाइना की भी इस वक्त एक तो हमारे साथ पॉलिटिकल हमारे जो कैपिटल अगर कहीं पे है तो सिर्फ वो चाइना है. इस वक्त हमें बड़ी रिस्पेक्ट की नज़र से देखा जाता है और बात यह एक लफ्ज़ है चाइनीज़ में उसका मतलब यह है कि आयरन ब्रदर्स. तो आयरन ब्रदर्स का वो एक कंसेप्ट वहाँ पे प्रिवेल करते हैं, जिस तरह हम यहाँ पे हमारे कुछ कंसेप्ट हैं हिमालिया से ऊंचे और वो कुछ डीप सी से जो हैं इस तरह से. तो बुनियादी एक चीज़ जो चाइना के लिए जो दो तीन मसाइल हैं, चाइना की सोसाइटी 30 साल में जिस तरीके से इन्होंने ग्रो किया वो हिस्टोरिकली आपको नहीं मिलेगा. अब जब आप इतनी तेज़ी से ग्रो करते हैं तो सोशल रिपरकशंस होती हैं, सोशल मसाइल जनरेट होती हैं, इनकम इनइक्वालिटी क्रिएट होती है. फिर चाइना का जो कोस्टल एरिया है वो तेज़ी से डेवलप हुआ, जो इंटरलैंड है वो अभी भी अंडर डेवलप है. और इंटरलैंड में न सिर्फ डेवलपमेंट एक बहुत बड़ा है ना एक मसला है, बल्कि वहाँ पर लैंड आर्डर का भी जो ईस्ट तुर्कमानिस्तान मूवमेंट वगैरह किस्म की जो वो हैं उसका भी एक बहुत बड़ा मसला है. तो चाइना चाह रहा है कि फोकस करें, क्योंकि 15th century में जब जहाज़ बड़े बड़े बने और उस पर हमने ट्रांसपोर्टेशन शुरू की तो कास्ट इफेक्टिव था कि हम जहाज़ों से ट्रेड करें. लेकिन अब एक और एलिमेंट इकोनॉमिक्स की प्रोडक्शन में आ गया कि वो है टाइम का. तो आप टाइम जितनी तेज़ी से आप मार्केट में चीज़ें पहुँचाएंगे आपको वहाँ पर इस पर बेनिफिट मिलेगा. तो एक ये चीज़ है. रही बात पाकिस्तान की, जिस तरह अगर साहब ने बात की डॉक्टर अतर साहब ने, पाकिस्तान में एक अलमिया ये है कि यहाँ पे जो स्कॉलर्स बैठे हुए हैं या जो पॉलिसी मेकर्स बैठे हुए हैं उनका बुनियादी मसला मैं समझता हूँ कि चीज़ों को वो हल नहीं कर पाते, इम्प्लीमेंट नहीं कर पाते. अगर बाहर से कोई चीज़ वहाँ पे आती भी है ना, मिसाल के तौर पे आप न्यू ट्रेड थ्योरी को देखें, अब ऐसी भी कोई टीचर्स और स्कॉलर होंगे जो पाकिस्तान पे उस थ्योरी को इम्प्लीमेंट करेगा, उसका दूर से भी ताल्लुक नहीं बनता. कोई भी ऐसी जो थ्योरी उठा लें उसके पाकिस्तान से, क्योंकि वो स्टेज पे नहीं है. आप स्टेज को देखें, उसके बाद हम दुनिया जहान की जो भी नई चीज़ निकालते हैं पाकिस्तान पे हम उसको इम्प्लीमेंट करते हैं जो गलत है. हमें थोड़ा देखना ये चाहिए कि हमारी कंडीशन क्या है, हालत क्या है और इसका इलाज क्या है. तो उस हिसाब से ही अगर डोज मिले न कि हाई न लो डोज तो पाकिस्तान तभी काम कर सकता है. अदरवाइज ये है कि ख्याली बातें या फिर ओवर रिएक्शन जो है ये चीज़ें इफेक्टिव नहीं रहती. थैंक यू.
जी हाँ, बिल्कुल सही कहा आपने. थैंक यू, बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया. मेरा ख्याल है कि काफ़ी टाइम हमने जो है वो मैंने ले लिया है. तो सबसे पहले मैं शुक्रिया अदा करना चाहती हूँ सरताज अजीज साहब का. आई रियली डू नॉट नो हाउ टू थैंक यू सर, क्योंकि मुझे जितनी ज़्यादा खुशी हो रही है उसको मैं अल्फाज में शायद एक्सप्रेस भी नहीं कर सकती कि आई एम सो हम्बल्ड कि आपने मेरी इन्विटेशन जो है वो कबूल की. और ये मेरा ख्याल है ज़िंदगी, मेरी ज़िंदगी के चंद यादगार वाक़यात में से एक है कि मैं आपके सामने वेबिनार पे या ऑनलाइन ही, अगर इन नॉट इन पर्सन बट ऑनलाइन, आई एम टॉकिंग टू यू एंड यू हैव taught us a lot. I mean, personally, मैंने आपसे बहुत लर्न किया है, और ये जो दो हजरात हैं डॉक्टर अख्तर सिंह, डॉक्टर हसनात, इनसे तो गाहे बगाहे मुलाकात होती रहती है, इन पर्सन भी होती है, ऑनलाइन भी होती है, बट आई ऑलवेज लर्न फ्रॉम एवरीबडी, इवन फ्रॉम माई स्टूडेंट्स. और सारी ज़िंदगी जो है मेरे ख्याल से सीखने का अमल इसी तरह होता है कि आप अपने बड़ों से, बुज़ुर्गों से तो डेफिनेटली सीखते हैं, बहुत लर्न करते हैं, आपके दिमाग के दरीचे बहुत खुलते हैं, लेकिन आप अपने कोलीग से, अपने स्टूडेंट से. हसनात, आई एम रियली वेरी हैप्पी टू टेल यू दैट हसनात हैज़ बीन माई स्टूडेंट. आई यूज़ टू टीच हिम, बट नाउ ही हैज़ रेज्ड टू दैट पोजिशन दैट ही इज़ नाउ. मैं तो ये नहीं समझती कि आप हसनात मेरे इक्वल हैं, आप मुझसे भी काफ़ी हाई पोजिशन पर हैं माशाल्लाह, यू आर प्रोफेसर नाउ. तो आप तीनों हजरात का बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया आपके टाइम का. अगर मौका मिला तो इंशाल्लाह मैं चाहूँगी कि सरताज अजीज साहब जो है इस इदारे में आएँ, एआरसी में तशरीफ लाएँ, इन पर्सन ज़रूर आएँ. ये हफीज़ पाशा साहब का इदारा है, उन्होंने ही यहाँ बनाया है, मेरे टीचर भी हैं, मेरे गाइड भी हैं, तो इस हवाले से भी जो है सरताज अजीज साहब की बहुत इज्जत और एहतराम है. तो मुझे बहुत ज़्यादा खुशी है कि आई रियली ट्रेजर दिस मोमेंट.
बहुत
बहुत शुक्रिया, बहुत बहुत
शुक्रिया, बहुत कलामी माफ. हम भी अपनी तरफ से सरताज अजीज साहब को शुक्रिया अदा करना चाहती हैं. तो एक ऑनर है हमारे लिए भी, हम चूंकि एक ऐसे स्टेज पे हैं जिसमें हमने बहुत कुछ लर्न किया है, इनके पास जिंदगी के तजुर्बात चीज़ें हैं, तो बहुत शुक्रिया. हम इस काबिल नहीं कि आपके साथ पैनल को शेयर करती, आपने हमें मौका दिया. थैंक यू सो मच मैम, थैंक यू सो मच डॉक्टर अकदर साहब, आपका बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया. थैंक यू,
थैंक यू सो मच, खुदा हाफिज़. थैंक यू.